Some people said the 200 died in the square, and others claimed the 2,000 died there. There are also stories of tanks in the square running over students who were trying to leave. I have to say that I did not see any of that. I don't know where those people did. I myself was in the square until 6:30 in the morning.
Facing the thousands of people who cheered me on, I was completely carried away. Now here I was, speaking at Tiananmen Square, I felt that my words could sway the fate of the nation.
In the early hours of June 3rd, army units once again attempted to get to the square. Most of the troops weren't in combat gear, but people were outraged to find that some were actually armed. Protesters confiscated guns, cattle prods, cleavers, and knives, and displayed them as proof that the government intended to use violence. Then they turned the weapons over to the city police. When day came, crowds had stopped buses being used to transport weapons into the city and were ejecting the soldiers. Troops stationed in the nearby Great Hall of the People were ordered out to retake the buses. They too were surrounded and stopped. So the soldiers sat down, and everyone started to sing. Soldiers and protesters, each hoping, perhaps, to sing the other side into submission. At the fringes of the singing match, nervous soldiers collided with excited citizens. On the evening of June 3rd, troops and armored personnel carriers began converging on the center of the city. Far from the square on Chang'an Avenue, the Avenue of Eternal Peace, the great east-west thoroughfare, troops encountered crowds at every intersection. This time, they would not be stopped. The crowds blocking the intersections didn't always disperse when fired on, or they ran away but came back to yell at the troops. The sound of gunfire attracted even larger crowds.
At that time, all was still quiet at the monument. Hoda Jen said that it was like being in the eye of the storm.
2 hours before the main body of the troops arrived, a single armored personnel carrier drove into the square.
Workers in Beijing residents stopped it. Someone hit it with a Molotov cocktail and it caught fire. The fire hardly slowed it down. Frankly, I was scared and got out of its way. Everyone got out of its way.
The official loudspeakers around the square suddenly came on and announced the emergency orders of the martial law troops. They said that the government was determined to suppress the counter-revolutionary violent rioting at all costs. The huge square, which had been filled with so many people, suddenly was emptying before my eyes. Only those of us on the monument remained. It really was eerie.
Having surrounded Tiananmen Square, the soldiers halted and awaited further orders.
At around 3 o'clock in the morning, several thousand students sat down at the monument. They wanted to stay to the very end. A lot of blood had already been shed that night, but most of the students in the square hadn't seen anything, so they didn't know what to believe.
We came up with a plan to negotiate with the troops. We thought we should send two people and ask Chai Ling to send another two representatives from the student headquarters. Together, we would ask the army to give us enough time to leave the square.
Chai Ling told us she had heard that leading government reformers hoped that the students would stay on the square until daybreak. So Liu Xiaobo told her, I don't care if it's true or not, but no leader has the right to gamble with thousands of students' lives at the square. A few minutes later, an officer appeared. He listened to what we had to say and went to report to his superiors. He came back and told us that they had agreed to our request. He said, we hope you can convince the students to leave the square. We rushed back to the monument to tell the students. Their opinions were divided.
Soldiers came right up in front of us. They were in full battle gear. The students all stood up. I was in the front row with a gun pointing straight at my chest. It was only a few inches away. The soldiers looked really mean. At the time, I was simply stunned. I didn't feel a thing. I can't imagine what would have happened had they really opened fire.
I was in charge of the vote to determine whether we should leave. I said, on the count of three, those who want to go, shout go. Those who want to stay, shout stay. I couldn't tell which side was louder.
I knew those who wanted to leave would be ashamed to shout very loud, while those who wanted to stay would shout with all their might.
Because of this situation, I felt that when the two sides sounded about the same, most likely more people voted to leave. So I announced the decision to leave.
Dawn on June 4th, after occupying the square for more than 3 weeks, all the remaining students and their teachers and supporters left Tiananmen Square. Tiananmen Square was empty, but skirmishes between the people and the army went on sporadically for several days. There were more deaths on both sides.
We filed out of the square from the southeast corner. I was near the end of the line. When we turned the corner at the concert hall, several tanks came up from behind. Suddenly, we heard shouts of panic. We looked back and saw people scrambling to get away, as a tank turned around right in the middle of the crowd. Then we heard screaming and crying. We ran as fast as we could, afraid that the tank was going to run over us. A student I knew, he was not from my university, practically crawled out from under the tank. Two of his classmates were crushed.
And now here is the full 40-minute message in which Chai Ling recounts what happened between June 3rd and June the 4th.
这段时间整个广岭的情况我想我是最有资格的评论家可是我们事后才知道仍然有一些同学他们对这个政府对这支军队还抱有希望他们以为顶多是军队把大家强行的架走他们太疲劳了还在 在帐篷里酣睡的时候坦克已经把他们点成肉饼有人说同学死了200多也有人讲整个广场已经死了4000多具体的数字到现在我们也不知道
Some people said that 200 died in the square, and others claimed that 2,000 died there. There are also stories of tanks in the square running over students who were trying to leave. I have to say that I did not see any of that. I don't know where those people did. I myself was in the square until 6:30 in the morning. I kept thinking, are we going to use lies to attack an enemy who lies? Aren't facts powerful enough? To tell lies against our enemy's lies only satisfies our need to vent our anger.